Good morning. On this long weekend Sunday, when it seems like perhaps the weather here in Calgary has turned a corner, and it feels like perhaps we are turning a corner in many ways. Thank you so much for joining us this morning here at Wild Rose United Church, where we seek to embody the beloved community of Jesus through radical welcoming, progressive theology, and social justice. No matter if you grew up in the United Church of Canada or had never attended any church before today, it's good that you've come. No matter if you are full of optimism and joy or burdened by shame or grief or fear or anger, there is a place for you. No matter if you come seeking answers or only wish to better understand the questions, all God's children of every color of the rainbow are embraced as sacred and treasured and made in the image of God. My name is Murray Spear. My personal pronouns are he and him, and I'm privileged to be the minister here at Wild Rose United Church. With me providing leadership today are Dan Somerville and Diane McKenzie, Karen Nell Bennett, Linda Ellis, Eileen Hartman, Bill Aitken, and Charlie Moore. And also thank you to our greeters, our counters, and our choir for supporting the service this morning. Wherever you are, if you're accessing the service on the internet, on Facebook, or on YouTube, I hope you'll do us a favor. Go to the comment or chat section if you are, and let us know who you are and that you're watching. Long before anyone who looked like me came to this continent from Europe or to this place where the bow and the elbow meet, called Mokinsis in Blackfoot and Calgary in English, there were people here. People who had been here from the beginning and who had fully developed systems of culture and politics and economics and spirituality. We acknowledge that history and acknowledge our relationships with our neighbors in the Treaty 7 First Nations. The Blackfoot Confederacy, comprising the Kainai, Piikani, and Siksika First Nations, and also the Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda First Nations, Wesley, Bearspaw, Chiniki, and Métis Nation of Alberta. We all have work to do in healing and reconciling the broken relationships of centuries. Thank you to everyone who supported the bedding plant fundraiser that went off a week and a bit ago. That was a successful day and helped us out with a little bit of funds, and hopefully you're pleased with the plants that you obtained, and hopefully they didn't fare too badly if you already put them in the ground a week ago. There is a new team starting up, starting next Sunday following the service, and then again 2 weeks later, which is a team that I'm hoping will be able to come together and help us bring creativity and variety and diverse expressions in our worship. So if you're at all interested in prayer or music or drama or preaching or anything having to do with worship, please consider joining us next Sunday after church, as well as on the 12th. And please let us know in the office so that we can be prepared. I think that's all the announcements that need some attention. So as we prepare ourselves for worship, Karen is going to lead us in our opening song. And while that's happening, Linda will light our Christ candle.
Please join me in the call to worship based on Psalm 119. Your part is in yellow. Teach me your holy ways, O God. Teach me to understand your path and follow it. Take my hand on the road that lies ahead. Tend to me in hardship and danger. Turn my eyes to sources of abundant life. Transform my pain with your righteousness. Amen.
As we gather for worship, we're called to open ourselves to the light of God's renewing love and have our burdens lessened and our spirits transformed. Let us welcome God's presence and lay our burden at the feet of the one who is always ready to listen. Let us pray. God of grace, we praise you and we celebrate your presence within and among us. All of earth and sky, time and space are not enough to contain your holiness. Come to us today as a parent to her child, to wipe away our tears and to comfort us in times of distress. We know that our lives are filled with barriers to your love, so that it is hard to hear your call and your promise of new life. Even when we are dissatisfied, it is easier to cling to what we know than to risk something else. We try to love who and what you love, but too often our discomfort overcomes your call to reach out. Melt away all the walls that divide us from one another and from you, so that your love can flow freely. Send us courage to embrace whatever and whomever you place in our path. Amen. The peace candle is a tradition that spreads from congregation to congregation. We're preparing, as we are preparing our gradual reopening, to begin spreading this tradition beyond our walls. Peace is characterized not by the absence of conflict, but by the presence of justice. Peace is the state that emerges in our midst when those who have much do not have too much, and those who have little do not have too little. When the very old and the very young feel supported and secure, parents can feed their children and themselves, and all have the opportunity for meaningful work in their community. As I light this candle, let us prepare ourselves, let us commit ourselves to pray and work for that kind of peace. Now Karen will lead us in a hymn.
Sorry.
The Bible reading we're going to hear in a minute is about different ways that we can be good. Different ways that we can be good for each other, and different ways that we can be good for other people in our community and even people we don't know. And it's also part of a bigger story about why we should be good for each other and for our community and for people that we don't even know. I wonder if we could think about why we should be good for each other. Folks here in the sanctuary, do you have any thoughts about why we should be good for each other? Anyone? I'm not looking for a right answer, I'm just looking for ideas. Wendy says, because it makes us feel good. It's true, it does make us feel good sometimes to be good for each other. Any other thoughts? Bill says it's because it's what you're supposed to do. Yeah, because certain authorities tell us what they want us to do and what we're supposed to do. Yeah, thanks, Bill. Any other ideas? Sorry, say again. Good for your health. It can be good for your health because you know what? If you are getting really angry and really tense and really upset all the time, that's not good for your body to be upset or to be angry or jealous.
It can brighten up, uplift the people around you.
That sounds like Linda behind me saying it's uplifting for people around you. Yeah, so if you care about someone, then maybe you want to be good for them. Yeah. I'm trying to, was that Hazel? That was Hazel. Hazel says that it's like an exchange, right? It's like an understanding that we have with other people. If we want them to be good for us, then we should be good for them. Mm-hmm. Now that was Linda again. Linda, you already said something. Or am I wrong? That was Linda. Pay it forward, that's actually a good suggestion, right? That if somebody has been good for us, then we can be good for someone else. Pay it forward instead of pay it back. The story that we're going to read in the Bible says that a better reason to be good for everyone is not only because we want them to be good for us, because if we're only doing it so that they'll be good for us, then maybe we only care about it if somebody knows that we did it, right? And it says that we should be good for other people not only because it's expected of us by the authorities, because sometimes the authorities aren't good either. And it says that the other reasons that we might be good for other people, now they're good reasons, but they aren't the best reason. The best reason is that at times in the past, both in our personal history and in the history of our families and our communities and our countries and our world, God has been good to us. And we should always remember the times when we were in need. So in today's story, it talks about when people were slaves. And in the bigger story, it talks about when they were immigrants and when they were refugees and when they were being chased by powerful enemies. And God was good to them. And it's not the same as I'm going to, it's not the same as I'm going to be good because everything has gone well for me.
everything has gone well for us. Maybe there's a lot that's gone bad for us. But we're going to be good because we remember what it was like to need somebody. And we can imagine what it's like to be the person in front of us, in our family, next door, in our group, who is in need now. And so we don't do it because of what they might do for us. We don't do it because of what they have done for us. We do it because other people need someone to be good for them. And we believe that God is good for us, and we believe that we can be good for other people. Thank you so much for listening today. I think we have a choir anthem next. Is that right? That is. Choir.
Today's reading is from Leviticus 19:1-5, 9-18, 9-33-37, adapted from the Common English Bible. The Holy One said to Moses, "Say to the whole community of the Israelites, you must be holy because I, your holy God, am holy. Each of you must respect your parents, and you must keep my Sabbaths. I am your holy God. Do not turn to idols or make gods of cast metal for yourselves. I am your holy God. When you sacrifice a communal sacrifice of well-being to the Holy One, offer it in the proper and acceptable way. When you harvest your land's produce, you must not harvest all the way to the edge of the field. And don't gather up every remaining bit of your harvest. Also, do not pick your vineyard clean or gather up all the grapes that have fallen there. Leave these items for the poor and the immigrant. I am your holy God. You must not steal, nor deceive, nor lie to each other. You must not swear falsely by my name, desecrating your God's name in doing so. I am the Holy One. You must not oppress your neighbors or rob them. Do not withhold a hired laborer's pay overnight. You must not insult a deaf person or put some obstacle in front of a blind person that would cause them to trip. Instead, fear your God. I am the Holy One. You must not act unjustly in a legal case. Do not show favoritism to the poor or deference to the great. You must judge your fellow Israelites fairly. Do not go around slandering your people. Do not stand by while your neighbor's blood is shed. I am the Holy One. You must not hate your fellow Israelite in your heart. Rebuke your fellow Israelite strongly so you don't become responsible for his sin. You must not take revenge nor hold a grudge against any of your people. Instead, you must love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Holy One. When immigrants live in your land with you, you must not cheat them. Any immigrant who lives with you must be treated as if they were one of your citizens. You must love them as yourself because you were immigrants in the land of Egypt. I am your holy God. You must not act unjustly in a legal case involving measures of length, weight, or volume. You must have accurate scales and accurate weights, an accurate bushel and an accurate gallon. I am your holy God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. You must keep all my rules and all my regulations and do them. I am the Holy One. Scripture is our song for the journey. God calls us doers of the word and not hearers only.
So I call this, the first part of what we heard Eileen read today, I call this the other Ten Commandments. I suspect you're at least somewhat familiar with the Ten Commandments. It's a portion of the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible. It appears in both in Leviticus and also in Deuteronomy. And it's the beginning of the laws that Moses delivers to the people in the story while they have after they have left Egypt. And Charlton Heston made a movie about it. And for much of the history of the church, particularly in the 19th and 20th centuries, they were considered extremely, extremely central. I've no doubt there are people here today or watching who remember having the Ten Commandments trained into them as children, to the point where if we started reciting them, we could probably piece them together as a group. And they hold up. They hold up. Except that there's this other set of Ten Commandments in Leviticus 19 that if we let ourselves think, as we let ourselves think for several generations, that you could boil all of the law that Moses delivered to the people from God down to those first 10, you might miss a few things. And so bringing in Leviticus 19, chapters 1 to 18, as the other Ten Commandments, introduces some interesting possibilities. Because let me just pull them up here, because 18 verses is a little bit long. It's longer than the first Ten Commandments, and they don't break down into 10 quite as nicely. Some of them are the same. So here's Leviticus 19, 1 to 18, boiled down into 10 commandments. Some of them are the same. Be holy as I am holy. Respect your parents and keep the Sabbath. Well, respect your parents, keep the Sabbath. Those are two of the Ten Commandments that many of us have learned as children. Do not worship the works of your own hands. That's one of the Ten Commandments that many of us learned as children. Do not steal, deceive, lie, or swear falsely. Well, that's one of them. But then listen to some of these others that I hope echo with what you heard Eileen read earlier. Share your abundance and do not hoard it. Help the needy and homeless. That's the bit in Eileen's reading that said, when you offer a community sacrifice, do it in the full and proper way, which means you bring a whole animal. You sacrifice a whole animal, you cook it that day, and it's eaten that day. Well, who's going to eat it? The people who have come to the priest who are starving. Do not harvest all the way to the edge of your field. Do not pick up the heads that fall on the ground. Do not harvest all of the grapes from your vines. Do not pick up the bunches of grapes that have fallen to the ground. Leave them for those who have no other source. Do not oppress or exploit your neighbor. Treat the disabled with respect. Did I skip over that one, Eileen? Did we read that one where it says, "Do not trip a blind person." Do not trip a blind person. Treat the disabled with respect. Act justly in disputes, favoring neither the poor nor the wealthy, but judging fairly. None of these are in the Ten Commandments. Do not spread gossip. Look after your neighbor. Have no hate in your heart, but respond to harmful behavior with a rebuke. Do not take revenge or hold a grudge, but love your neighbor as yourself, which is indeed, in the words of Jesus from our New Testament, one of the two greatest commandments. All of this talk about care for the poor, fairness for the immigrant, respect for the disabled. Rebuking your neighbor, but not hating them. For generations, for a couple of centuries, we hung our Christian ethic on a group of 10 rules that contained none of that. The theme this month is the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, and the tagline for the theme is literal law or spiritual ideal. And we've spent 2 weeks. 2 weeks ago, I was here. Last week, I wasn't able to be here. I haven't watched the video back, but thanks to Linda and Karen and everybody who stepped in and pulled off that service. We haven't talked about law yet. Because the first 2 weeks, we just talked about Moses. We talked about Moses as a boy and as... He's fine, Heather. He can come up if he wants to. Talked about Moses as a boy and as a young man, growing into an adult, returning to confront Pharaoh about the enslavement of his people. And then last week, Moses and his siblings, Aaron and Miriam, leading the Israelites out of Egypt. God rescuing them from Pharaoh's army. Because that story was necessary to understand this law that Moses is delivering. It's necessary to understand that the people who are hearing these instructions are not living in comfortable conditions. The people in the story to whom Moses is delivering these instructions have just fled from the only home they've ever known. They're in the wilderness. They are without any sense of security or continuity. Hi, you need to come up? No, you're going to stay down there? Okay. It's my 1.5-year-old. It's the first time he's in the sanctuary during worship because he was born during the pandemic. And the story itself is all of these regulations being delivered to these people who have no home of their own, no security in themselves, no sense of continuity with previous generations. Their parents, their grandparents, their great-grandparents for 500 years were born and raised in Egypt as an ethnic minority, liberated, and now they are free. They are homeless. Instructions are being given to them for when they have a home. When you are the dominant culture, remember what it was to be the immigrant, the minority, the slave. When you are in your comfortable homes, remember what it is to lack security. When you are surrounded by people who look and talk and worship like you, remember what it is to be the refugee. That's what's happening in the story. What's happening around the story as it is being written is something very different because, as we know, as we've discussed before, at the time of Moses, there was very little literature. People weren't writing things down. It's not reasonable to expect that they remembered for 600, 700 years that this is what Moses said for a time like this. These words are written at a time when even though they have homes, even though they have a country of their own, they are under tremendous threat. If you remember some of the history we've talked about, the unified kingdom of Israel that existed under Kings Saul and David and Solomon, it was never completely unified. That entire 100 years was riddled by civil wars and conflicts. After the time of King Solomon, split into two, into the southern kingdom called Judah, the northern kingdom called Israel. And a few hundred years after that, the northern kingdom fell and never returned. It was destroyed by an empire called the Neo-Assyrians. Refugees from the north flooded into the kingdom of Judah. And it was necessary to develop a common language, a common story of origins that emphasized their shared history, emphasized their shared identity in a way that it had not been emphasized before. It was necessary to combine these two populations that had been separated for half a millennium, who thought of each other as cousins, but not close cousins. And now they're living together. They have to come to some understanding of how they belong together and how they can continue. Because the Neo-Assyrian Empire, it fell, but the Babylonian Empire rose in its place. Egypt to the south remains a constant threat. And they have to decide how they're going to live in this state of having their own land, but being afraid of the powers outside their borders. And so this literature is born, drawing together certain ancient stories, drawing together certain ancient understandings, including ancient figures, but written for a time when people can read and understand. And it does two things. It does two things. On the one hand, this is the part that we might cringe at, we might not want to read, we might not want to hear it in Sunday worship. We might prefer that it wasn't there. It says, destroy all the other forms of worship in this country. There will be no official worship in this country other than the worship of God, the Holy One. Now, what people do in their own homes, presumably, there was very little control over that, but public official worship sites were completely converted to the worship of God, the Holy One. And the other thing it did was it said, welcome the outsider. If there is someone in your country who represents in your eyes the dangers that exist outside your border, if there is someone who has come to live in your country who is Egyptian, who speaks Egyptian, follows Egyptian customs, if there's someone who has come to live in your country who is Assyrian or who is Babylonian, who follows those cultures and speaks those languages, even though you are afraid of their government outside your borders, you welcome that person. You demonstrate to the rest of the world that while you are you do things your way, you speak your language, you follow your worship, you are no one's enemy. You do not persecute them. You do not deport them. You do not exclude them. You do not judge unfairly against them in court. You do not deny them opportunities for commerce and business. They're trying to walk a narrow way of remaining who they are, of not succumbing to the pressures of foreign empires, but also remaining good for themselves and for their residents and in the eyes of the world. The reason I call this topic literal law or spiritual ideal is because we have no idea how well it was ever followed historically. We have no idea how closely the laws in the book of Leviticus were ever truly observed, ever truly upheld. Did the priests follow all of them, and some of the people, but not all the people? Maybe. Did some of the priests follow all of them, and some of the priests didn't, and very few of the people? Maybe. Did none of the priests follow them completely, and none of the people follow them completely? That's possible too. But it's still with us as an ideal. And if we let ourselves focus on the moral side of the law, the original Ten Commandments, the main Ten Commandments, the first Ten Commandments that we were taught, many of us as children, which are all about the moral behavior of the individual, not killing, not stealing, not lying. And we forget the social aspects of the law. The ones that say, judge fairly between the poor and the rich in court and in lawmaking. Don't disadvantage the poor for the sake of the rich. Don't disadvantage the rich just because they're rich. If we forget where it says, don't hold a laborer's pay overnight, meaning pay him at the end of the day so that he can go and buy his meal for the day, pay for his bed for the night, and pay him so that he doesn't have to come back to you in the morning if he doesn't want to. See, these rules, they seem obscure. They seem meaningless. They seem like we can say, oh, don't withhold a laborer's pay overnight. That can't possibly have any relevance in our world. But it means you give him his freedom to go work for someone else the next day if he wants to. He doesn't have to come back to you because you owe him money. If we ignore the laws that say, treat the immigrant and the outsider as though they were a citizen. Not necessarily in all of their rights and privileges, but in the way they are treated by the system. If we ignore the laws that say, rebuke harmful behavior, but have hate in your heart for no one, and focus only on the narrow individual moral expectations of the law. Then we are forgetting. We're forgetting the story that laid the entire basis for the delivery of this law, which is the story of Abraham leaving his parents, living as a foreigner, Abraham's grandson and Jacob and Jacob's children, traveling to Egypt during a famine, living in Egypt as immigrants, living in Egypt 500 years as an ethnic minority, becoming enslaved. And being freed from Egypt, but living with no security and no continuity. If we forget the time that we, whether we are descended directly from Jacob or descended spiritually from Jacob, the time that we were immigrants, minorities, slaves, wanderers. Then we not only risk, we guarantee that we repeat the very worst parts of that history, with ourselves no longer in the role of the outcast, the oppressed, but in the role of the oppressor and the torturer. When Jesus is asked in our New Testament for us as Christians, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus does not refer to what we consider the Ten Commandments. He refers to both. He refers to the beginning of the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy chapter 8, which says, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is one. Love the Lord with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And then he refers to Leviticus chapter 19. Love your neighbor as yourself. It can be easy to say, I don't need Leviticus. It's full of ridiculous, outdated, arcane, barbaric rules. But it helps us remember. There was a time, no matter who we are, no matter where we're from, there is a time in our lives when we were vulnerable, where we were afraid, where we had needs. And it tells us that our job as people of faith is to find the places in our world where there are people who are vulnerable, who are afraid, who have needs, and do our best not to obey the law, but to fulfill the ideal of our ancestors in faith. May it always be so. Karen's going to lead us in another hymn. As we pray together in community, the concerns of each of us are shared by all of us. If you would like to be included in our weekly prayer concerns email, please let us know at the office and we'll sign you up for that. If you have concerns to share, you can send those, pardon me, to pastoralcare@wildroseunited.ca. Today in our regional council prayer cycle, we are remembering the people in ministries of Southminster United Church in Lethbridge, Alberta. And in our World Council of Churches prayer cycle, we are remembering the people and churches of the Indian Ocean Islands, Comoros, Madagascar, Maldives, Mauritius, and Seychelles. Let us pray. Blessed Jesus Christ, you have overcome death and risen in our midst and are alive forevermore. Help us never to forget your loving presence with us. Help us to remember that you are with us in every time of perplexity to guide and to direct us. That you are with us in every time of sorrow to comfort and to counsel us. That you are with us in every time of temptation to strengthen and to inspire us.
that you are with us in every time of loneliness to cheer and befriend us. That you are with us even in death to bring us to completion and renewal and restoration. And we name before you now in a time of silence all who are in our hearts, we pray silently together. We ask all this for your love's sake. Amen. And we gather these in all our prayers, thankful that we may turn to you as to a grandmother who watches over us, and pray together as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Now on the screen, also available on our website, are all of the ways that we can contribute to the ongoing ministries of Wild Rose United Church. Thank you so much for all you have given and continue to give. If you're here in the sanctuary and like are the kind of person who likes to drop something in a plate, there's one towards the exit over here and another by the column there. There was often, used to be one right in front of me here, but it's not there today. For those of you who are at home or after we go home today, there are multiple options for sending in our contributions. All of our offerings further the renewing and reconciling work of God and the church that we are called to join. And as we contemplate our offering, we have an offering of music from Karen and Dan.
Love can build a bridge. Yes. you think it's time? Don't you think it's time? Don't you think it's time? Love and only love. Love and only
Let us pray. God of life, we want to spread the gifts we have found to all your people. May our offerings represent our desire to change our hearts and to be a source of grace in your world. Amen. Now may the power of God's love, which has raised Jesus to new life, strengthen you in hope, enrich you with love for all, and fill you with joy and faith today and always. Amen.